Welcome back to part 4 of A Beautiful Game. In this part, we're going through MaterialX, VEX, and the USD Preview Shaders. So, with the introduction of Karma, comes the ability to use different types of shaders. In the past, we've been limited when using Mantra to the VEX-based shaders. That's the principal shader that I'm sure many of you are familiar with. And now, we have access to MaterialX and the USD Preview Shader. The intention with MaterialX is that it can be used by other renderers, and you shouldn't have an issue switching between delegates. There's also the USD Preview Shader, and that is a somewhat simplified shader that can be used for interchangeable assets, so you can move them between different Hydra delegates. If we open up the part 4 MaterialX underscore vex.hip scene file, you should see this. Now, if you are not familiar with Solaris, this might seem a bit weird, but we are in the Solaris desktop. If you go up over here, you can see that by default, you'd be in like the bold desktop, but we've switched to the Solaris desktop. It gives you access to the scene graph and a couple of other things, right? It changes what geometry you have access to and your LOP lights and cameras. What you will notice is a little LOP network, right? It has VEX and MaterialX. If we dive inside here, you'll see a basic setup where we just have these chess pieces being pulled in into a material library, materials are being assigned, then we have a camera and a dome light. So I'm going to take you through the process of rebuilding a MaterialX and a VEX shader side by side, and we can compare the workflow and how they look when rendered. So this material library over here is for reference, so I'm going to move this over and call this reference library. And you can use this if you want to compare what you've done with how it should be done. And so we now have that over to the side. What we're going to do is drop a material library. So if you're unfamiliar, we're just bringing in the chess pieces. These are referenced in, they are USD assets. Once again, if you're not familiar with the USD Solaris workflow, feel free to go check out a basics tutorial on how to use Solaris and LOPs. This isn't a LOPs tutorial, so I'm not going to be spending much time explaining LOPs concepts. This is a rendering tutorial and a Karma tutorial. So just to clear that up, in case anyone's coming into this expecting to learn about LOPs. If we take a look at what we have, right? Right now, what we have with our light setups, our cameras, if we switch to the Karma render mode, so once again, this is the viewport render, we just have two simple king pieces, right? Identical, there's nothing going on. One is the MaterialX and one is the VEX, but they don't really have anything on them at the moment. So let's go ahead and dive into this material library, and let's start with what we know, the principled shader. So we're going to drop down a principled shader, and we can call this VEX-based king. When we're making a VEX-based shader, we generally set the color over here, base color, to white, because we don't want it multiplying with whatever we bring in. We will set the roughness on specular to 1, because we want this to be affected by, once again, the textures that we are bringing in. We're also going to have metallic, so we can push metallic up to 1 over here, and we're going to have subsurface scattering. We'll come back to the subsurface distance in a bit, but this is basically all we need over here, right? We're just setting up a bunch of things, and we're now going to be able to apply our textures. So if we go over to the textures, we can say use texture, and that will allow us to go and find a texture to use on a particular piece. So we're going to find the texture for this. So just go ahead, and inside of the hip file, you will see textures, king textures, and then we can go to king black textured. So over here, you'll see that we have this default material base color. That is our base color, so we can just bring that in. We'll go down and find our roughness. Once again, we'll bring in a texture for that. So that will be our roughness over there. Metallics, we can get over here. Metallic, just bring that in. Finally, all the way down here, we have subsurface and subsurface color. These are two different things. Subsurface defines where you have subsurface. So we're going to go ahead and choose default material scattering. And then for the subsurface color, we're going to go ahead and just choose our base color again. So now that we have all of that set up, before we go into displacement or anything, let's just assign that. So on our material library node, to assign a material to a piece of geometry, we're just going to disable include only VARPs with material flag set. We're then going to say assign to geometry. We're going to grab our king vex over here. So that is our vex based king piece. And that will assign materials to the king. But we want to be more specific. And so we're just going to say vex underscore based king, and that's the material that we're assigning. And so if we go to the Karma viewport now and select render, you'll see this. Now, if the background is too distracting for you, you can press D while hovering on the viewport, go over to background, and display environment lights as backgrounds can be disabled, just like that. So The next thing we want to do is work on our displacement and bump map. So let's go ahead into this VEX base king over here. And before we move on to that, we'll change our subsurface distance. So we've set up our subsurf, but it looks a bit weird. So we'll go 0.001, and that should sort out our displacement. So we can go ahead to our bump and normals and say enable. Over here, we'll go to our texture path and we'll choose normal OpenGL right over there. That'll be all for our bump. Over to our displacement, we'll activate texture displacement. We'll choose our texture path, and that is just the default material displacement. And you'll see that comes in looking kind of odd. And displacement is actually calculated just before the render begins. So for it to be correctly calculated, you need to restart your render. So restart the render over there, just by clicking on the comma perspective, and then just saying restart render. So now you can see that we have it over here. This looks a little bit too intense. So effect scale, we can drop to 0.02, and that's our first piece done. So that is the VEX-based shader. Many of you may be familiar with that from working in Mantra. Now to go ahead and create a material X is a little bit different. So we're going to go over to the side, and this is a workflow that some of you may be familiar with. We're going to begin with a collect node. So this is actually the output. What we need to do with this though is to just rename it. So we're going to call this MTLX based king. And this is what is output. Like you can see that we have an output node on our principal shader, same thing on our collect node. The way the collect node works is it takes a shader and displacement separately and combines them. So we can use the MTLX standard surface. And that will go into the first input of our material X based king, that is the collect node. So on here, we're going to disable the render flag for it, and we can go ahead and just apply this up one level. So we can increase the number of materials. And over here, we're going to grab our king material X, that's our next geometry path. And the material VOP that we would like to use is MTLX underscore based underscore king. Right, so now we can see that this one is this over here, and we can test this with base color. As you can see, we have now applied material X. So we're going to need a bit of space because material X doesn't have the option for us to simply select our map as we can with the principal shader. So with material X, you're going to need to import all of your textures separately. To do this, we're going to use the material X image, just like that. And this will give us a way to import. So the color signature is going to be color. The file name that we want is going to be whatever we're connecting this to. So you can start renaming these to things like base, and that will be your base color. You plug that into base color, you go ahead and you grab it from the file name. So over here, we just go file name, base color, right? So you can already see that it's starting to resemble each other, and then we can continue for the rest of them. So I'm just going to duplicate this by holding Alt, clicking and dragging down, and we can call this one rough. Plug that into the specular roughness, go ahead and choose the roughness map. And this time we won't be using color, but rather we'll be using float, just because this is a black and white image. Roughness is black and white, so just change this to float. That will give you the correct values. I'm going to once again duplicate our material X. This time I'm going to grab the metalness. So let's go ahead and find metallic right over there. And this one is going to be a float once again. So we plug that straight into metalness. And now we have our metals set up. Just call this metallic. Okay, so we're going to duplicate metallic, grab our subsurface scattering. So that's just scattering. Call this SSS and plug that into our subsurface. And to get a better idea of our subsurface, we're going to go over to the material X. Under subsurface, we can change our scale to 0.003. Now, remember in the other one, what we did was we attached the base color as our subsurface color as well. So we're going to do the same over here. We're just going to take this into subsurface color, just like that. So this issue of our subsurface being too extreme is actually just because we need a much lower subsurface scale on this. So we can drop this to 0.003, so a tenth of what we had, and that should be fine. Of course, you can make adjustments so that these two match better, but that's not entirely the point of this. So next, we're going to make another material X image. This one is going to be a color. We can rename this to normal. So for this one, we're going to select our normal OpenGL, but we're going to need an extra node over here. We're going to be needing the MTLX normal map. So you can find it right over there. Plug this in into the in, and then from there, we go into our normal map. So once again, ensuring that this is set to a signature of color. into the normal map, into the normals. And I'm going to further reduce our subsurf just until I feel that they match a bit better. Okay, sorry, that was bothering me. So let's go ahead and do the displacement. So displacement, like I said, isn't actually part of this MaterialX shader. It goes into your collect node. So we're going to be grabbing another MaterialX image. So once again, I'm going to duplicate this over. This is going to be our displacement. We're going to choose our displacement, and then we're going to drop down an MTLX displacement node. Grab it over here, plug this into the displacement. We're going to plug this straight into this shader over here. And like I said, we need to restart the render. But this is going to be way too hectic for what we actually want. So we first need to drop this to about 0.02. And you'll notice that you still have this really fat piece. And that's just because of the space that MaterialX expects your displacement to be in. If we go over to the principled shader and we go over to displacement, you'll see that it has an offset of negative 0.5. In our case, we want to match that. So we're going to need to do an MTLX remap. With this remap, we're taking our values of 0 to 1, and we're going to go from negative 0.5 to 0.5. So to affect all values uniformly, we won't go with signature of color, we'll go color FA. And from 0 to 1, we'll go from negative 0.5 to 0.5. And we can restart that render. And there we have it. So we have our two materials set up. And that's all that we really need to do here. So if we go up a level, that's what we now have. So now if we also just go down and set our display flag to our Karma render node, and then just increase the pixel samples just to something closer to what we did in the previous part, we can take a look at what this looks like in our viewport. And the reason I'm bringing this up is because I want to show you something. So as I mentioned in the previous part, VEX shaders aren't exactly supported by XPU. So this is CPU. And if we switch it to XPU, so I'm just going to stop this, switch it to XPU, and go back and render it again, you'll notice that these two now look different, right? We don't have displacement on the one on the left. So we can try one other thing. Let's go back into our material library. We can put all of this into one network box, put this into one, and over on the right-hand side, I'm going to drop down the USD preview surface. So it's just a node that looks like this. So we have this USD preview surface. I'm just going to change this to USD based king. So this node is kind of interesting in that it can work with MaterialX nodes. For example, if we take from the base color that we have over on the side with our MaterialX out from our base color, we can plug that straight into the base color of this over here. And if I now take this and replace one of them, we can see what that does. So I'm going to go to our material library, and instead of doing the VEX base king, we can do the USD based king. So that would have changed that. And just to make sure, we can switch to Karma. But before I do that, I'm going to set it back to CPU. Now, if we let this run, you can see that is our USD based material. So you can take from MaterialX, which is cool, but you can also do it from the USD node. So we have the USD UV texture. If we go ahead and choose the file location over here as base color and plug that into our diffuse color, you'll notice that it doesn't work because it's not picking up our UVs. To get our UVs, we're going to have to use a bind node. So when we bind, we're bringing in an external attribute. We're bringing in UV in this case, and it is a vector. Plug that into ST. ST is just another representation of UV. So we now have UV into ST. That puts this into the correct UV space. And we have that going into diffuse color. So that also works. However, you can't have something that is VEX-based in between here. So if I had to do something like a multiply, and then we have perhaps a constant, so obviously this, when plugged into RGB, would kind of scale everything down, right? So if we do like 0.5 and then plug this in, that doesn't work. So we can't use those in between, but we can use the MaterialX math nodes. So we can do stuff like multiplying, but with MaterialX. So MaterialX multiply over here. And if we had to plug that in and then drop this to about 0.5, you'll see that we lose some color, right? It gets more grayed. So that's kind of interesting. And this node over here doesn't need to be collected. You can see that it does have surface and displacement. However, you can just duplicate this over, switch this to displacement. I'm not going to remake the entire material, but here we have our displacement, and you'd go from RGB into displacement. In this case, we don't actually need RGB. We can just use R. And so if I go into displacement, you'll notice that we have that issue that we had before where it's too extreme. But what you'll notice is that on the USD preview surface, we don't have options for displacement amounts, right? We want to multiply this. So again, we would have to use a MaterialX multiply. And if we multiply this by about 0.02, you'll see that we have the issue where it's no longer in the correct range. So we'll use the MaterialX remap. And by remapping over here with that, you will get the correct value. So you would have negative 0.5 and 0.5. And once again, that is correct. So we can drop this further if need be. And now you have two materials that both work. And you can go further with this. So you could do metallics and all of that. And this node over here, what you will notice is that it does not have subsurface scattering. This is supposed to be a more basic node. So if you need more specific control, you would want to use a different type of shader, such as MaterialX or a VEX-based shader. So in this case, I can show you that displacement does in fact work with XPU. So I'm just going to set this to Houdini GL, back to Karma, now using XPU. And as you can see, they both have displacement. So just a quick overview of what we did. We have now made a MaterialX, we have made a VEX-based shader, and we've made a USD preview material. In CPU, all three of these work. In XPU, only the USD preview material and the MaterialX work as intended. Now, XPU is still in alpha, but it is never going to support VEX-based materials. So the powerful thing about using MaterialX is that if you're using a different renderer, if that renderer is supported, you don't have to recreate your material. So if you were to move to RenderMan as opposed to using Karma, you could just plug this into a RenderMan output node and use the same materials that you already have if you are using MaterialX. So that's it for this part. Hopefully that helps you understand how to just assign these materials, how to create MaterialX, how to create VEX-based shaders, and just a brief overview of USD preview surfaces. So I will see you in part 5, where we will begin on actually rendering with Karma and rendering a scene, setting up lights, and all of that within Solaris. So that's it for this tutorial. I will see you next time. Bye.